and gentlemen, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I will be talking about the fracture mechanics of irradiation-assisted stress corrosion cracking effect. My name is Milan Konstantinovic, and I come from Belgian Nuclear Institute in Mol. So let me begin by introducing my institute. So Belgian Nuclear Institute, or SEKCN in short, exists since 1952. We have about 700 people, out of which 50% do have academic degree, and we have at the year level about 70 PhD students. So we exist because Belgium is a nuclear country. We have 7 operating nuclear power plants in Belgium, located 4 reactors in Toul and 3 in Tionge, producing about 6 gigawatts electric power, which covers about 60% of our electricity needs. We have also three research reactors in Mol. Mol is about here, east part of Belgium. And our annual turnover is about 140 million euros, out of which a little bit less than half comes from government, and the rest is supported through the contractual work. Our mission is related to safety of nuclear installations, as well as to radiation protection of men and environment. We do a lot of R&D related to safe treatment and disposal of radioactive waste. Through collaboration with universities in Belgium and in Europe, we contribute to the spread of knowledge, education and communication, and of course we provide services to nuclear industry, medical sector and the government. Our main infrastructure is the Belgium Reactor 2. Schematics of this reactor you see here. It's light water cooled, very moderated material testing reactor. Due to very, very specific design of the core, you see it being made out of twisted fuel element. We obtain very high density in the middle of the reactor, which gives us a very high thermal and fast neutron flux of about 10 to the 15 neutron per centimeter per second. This is highest in Europe, not including Russia. So we can perform material irradiation testing, irradiation in the middle in the channels coming close to the middle of the reactor, either in the empty channels or those in the axis of the fuel element. So those who have interest in the irradiation materials, please come to us, we can discuss possibilities. So with respect of my talk, I will introduce first the IACC, irradiation assisted stress corrosion cracking effect, and then I will describe the physical model based on fracture mechanics, and then I will try to discuss how this model applies to existing data of IACC. IACC or irradiation assisted stress corrosion cracking is intergranular cracking of the material, and it's a complex phenomenon which occurs through an interplay of different material degradation processes. So the factors that influence IACC susceptibility are heavy neutron irradiation, elevated temperature, elevated stresses, and the water corrosion because material is in direct contact with the PWR water. In spite of a lot of effort in the past, since the establishment of the nuclear energy, one of the main questions, which is still not yet fully understood, is related to crack initiation, which occurs in these type of materials, which are used. Typically, we talk about the stainless steel or internal components in the nuclear power plant. But this effect, radiation-assisted stress corrosion cracking, can cause the cracking of the buffer balls. So this is the screw which holds together formed to buffer assembly, which is supporting the nuclear core in a typical nuclear power plant. If the crack occurs in the bolt, this screw has to be replaced, which is quite an important both safety and economy issue for the nuclear power plants. So because of that, nuclear industry expressed a lot of interest in understanding this complex phenomenon. IACC can be tested or experimentally studied by performing a constant load test, type of test. In this type of test, we take a specimen, we put it in a constant load. So typically, we talk about irradiated specimen, which is under the load, placed in the autoclave, under the water corrosion effects, which are exactly the same in the nuclear power plant. And then we simply measure time to failure. So the applied stress is a typically fraction of the yield stress of the component. So if you talk about heavy irradiated 360 stainless steel, so we talk about the yield stress, which is of the order of 1,000 megapascals. So here in this graph, the O-ring, which is part of the cylindrical timbal tube is simply the cylinder which is used in nuclear power plant to insert the probes like a temperature probe or flux probe. So the specimen O-ring is placed under the stress, in this case between 700 and about a little bit more than 400 megapascals, and we simply measure the time which is needed for this component to fail, completely break. So we notice that by performing this type of test, that the sample will fail faster in time than loaded with high stress values. So simply you can see this by decreasing the applied load, the time to failure increases. And yes, then one can make an estimation of the stress threshold under which no ICC will take place. And it's about 40% of the radiated yield stress. You can see also here I plot the stress threshold to be somewhere at the level of 400 megapascals. The most important out of all is that typically in this type of test we perform the large scatter in the time to failure data, which somehow limits the application of the proposed stress threshold. Coming back to the previous graph, you can see, for example, for the applied stress of about 500 megapascal, we see the scatter for the time to failures ranging between, let's say, 80 or 70 hours, almost up to 2,000 hours. So it's a large scatter, which you typically observe in this type of experiments. Similar uncertainties are also observed by buffer bulk cracking in nuclear power plants. So people typically say that some bulbs do not crack, well, you would expect them to crack because of their symmetrical position with respect to the crack bolt. There are about 1,000 bolts in the nuclear power plant. People can compare symmetrical positions and they see that sometimes bolts crack, sometimes they do not. So we simply assign this to the similar uncertainties as in an experimental type of test. So one of the major questions is how to understand the origin of the scatter in this type of experiments or the occurrence of the cracking probability of the cracking of the buffer bolts. So let me come to the model. Let's assume that you have a formation of the oxide on top of the surface of the 316 stainless steel. And this typical, this oxide is made out of spinel or nickel chromium iron type of the oxide. And let's assume that we have a oxidized or generally weakened the grain boundary due to heavy neutron irradiation. Then one can assume or make assumption that in the first approximation, the crack will occur at the surface and then propagates, and with certain probability it will find the grain boundary and cause the failure of the specimen at the end. So in that case, once again, as a first approximation, we can say that the fracture of such a component is governed by the quasi-brittle fracture of keramical material, because the oxide is nothing but the ceramics. So what's the consequence of this? The consequence is that we have to think about subcritical crack propagation process, which typically occurs in a ceramic type of material. And this means that crack growth under the applied stress, which is well below the K1C. People talk in the literature about delay of failure or static fatigue even in this type of effects, because they talk about really very slow crack growth process. And of course, initiation occurs due to interaction with water, and then we have a irradiation effect which is generally responsible for the weakening of the grain boundary. So how do we calculate the time to failure in this type of model? Let's start for a general expression, stress intensity factor being correlated with the crack length. So we assume that we have a constant stress. The crack length will slowly grow, stress intensity factor will grow until it reaches the critical value, and then we have a failure. So we can take a derivative of this and then combine this with the standard Paris law for fatigue. I said previously that people consider this as being a static fatigue type of effect. And then one can, out of these two equations, simply correlate time to failure being inversely proportional to the sigma stress applied stress to the power of n. N is simply susceptibility for the crack. So okay, this is just a correlation between time to failure, and we don't have initial condition here. But one can immediately see that any two points in the time to failure diagram can be strictly being correlated to each other via reciprocal values of the applied stress. So any two points I and j should be correlated with, could be correlated with each other to sigma I and sigma j to the power of n. So this is what I plot here. I take as the first value Ti, the first value here, or any other value there, and I simply take n exponent being a typical value for most of the ceramics and the oxide. So n is between the 10 to the 20. So here I take, let's say, value for aluminium oxide, n being 15, because this type of exponent is not known for spinels, which is a typical oxide form on 316 stainless steel. So this is the curve one can obtain. It describes very well the behavior of the experimental data. One can see, one can read more about these experiments in the article which is published in the Journal of Nuclear Materials. So once again, initial value of the strength is not known, but one can safely assume that for samples which are tested at very high stress levels, with a failure which is of the order of several hours, that we talk about initial strength of the oxide being of the order of 700 megapascals. So in the literature, once again, there are no measurements of the initial strength of the spinel. But we know that, for example, aluminium oxide has a strength of 400 megapascals, zirconium oxide 900 megapascals. There is also interesting experiments performed by my colleague Thierry Coumon in EDF, which simply measured the stress to field threshold on the oxidized sample by combining tensile and scanning electron microscope. So he observed that the crack starts to occur in the oxide at the values of 750 megapascals, which is very close to the initial stress estimates coming from our experiment. Okay. The most important part is once again related to the evaluation of the scatter. How we evaluate the scatter in this type of experiment. So let's look at the Weibull distribution analysis. So one can do the Weibull distribution analysis for both strengths and the time to failure. So let's write a typical Weibull distribution. Here the sigma is a strength, is a stress, V is volume, and M is typical Weibull exponent. You can write this to both stress and the time to failure. Thanks to the correlation between time and stress, one can correlate, in fact, the exponents, variable exponents, tau and m. So if we take n being much larger than 1, as it did is the case for most of the oxides, we find that n value is about between 10 and 20, we can immediately see that tau must be much smaller than m. So variable exponent for time to failure should be much smaller than the variable exponent of the variable stress. So let's take again, n being equal to 15, m being equal to 10, so tau should be of the order of 1. So immediately we see that the stress distribution, the Weibull distribution of the time to failure will be much larger than the Weibull distribution of the strength. But then I can use this exponent and calculate, in fact, what is the 90% for failure in the case of Weibull statistics. So what I take here is simply tau being equal to 1, and I take initial time in the range being relevant for the experimental time to failure ranges. So starting from 50 hours up to 1,000 hours. So immediately we see that 90% failure dramatically increases by increasing the time. Then I can calculate, in fact, the 90% failure probability envelope for this type of time to failure stresses. And you can see very nice, almost excellent agreement between experimental data and the calculation. So there are no fitting parameters here. Simply, all parameters which are taken are corresponding to the typical values which are found for the oxide or ceramic type of materials. 90% probability envelope almost entirely describe the time to failure type of data obtained from the constant load or in testing of irradiated material. Well, this is not the end of the story, because if you take besides our own data, which we got as SEK, also some literature data, we can see that now there is the 90% probability envelope that I calculated in the previous graph do not fully describe the data that you can find in the literature. So for example, here I plot besides SEK data, which are these full symbols, I also plot the Westinghouse data. Also they are encircled. Those that do not agree with the 90% failure per bit envelope are encircled here. So how can we explain this, or can we explain also this? The answer is yes. So let's assume that we have the oxide thickness effect, and then try to calculate the volume dependence of the oxide strength, and to see if this can be reproduced correctly time to failure data. So coming back again to the statistical aspect, let's take a look on the Weibull distribution of initial strength and focus on the effect of the volume. And so here, in the previous graph, I ignored this V to V0 effect, and I analyzed only the statistics coming from the initial strength. So if you take into account V over V0, and I simply assume that two cases, V over VI equal to 1, which was also the previous case, and also some volume effect, or reduction of the oxide surface, V to V1 being 0.1. In that case, you see this is the red curve for the volume effect. We see that materials become effectively stronger. But this is not surprising, because for brittle material, there is less probability of finding the crack of certain length if material is thinner. So if you take a brittle material and you make a specimen thinner, it will effectively become stronger. This is a very well-known fact. And simply out of this, when I now take into account, we see that the 90% probability failure range, including volume effect, will be larger at larger stress. So if I now plot this 90% or add this 90% failure probability into the previous graph, this is what I get. In fact, now the 90 probability envelope can be extended here, and essentially this part being relevant for higher stress and for shorter time can be related to the volume effect. Once again, by assuming very simple model, we can fully reproduce the time to failure data which is available in the open literature. Okay, let me conclude. Uncertainties of the time to failure data being seen in a constant load boring type of specimens are in fact intrinsic effect in the failure of quasi-brittle fraction of oxides. Weibull failure analysis using typical value of the oxides can fully reproduce both time to failure and its uncertainties. The crack initiates at the surface and propagates through the oxidized weakened grain boundary, and this is radiation is in fact responsible for this part of the material properties. So this work needs experimental confirmation. So this is just a model which describes some mechanical failure data. But there are some indications that this model is relevant. First of all, the time to failure data in fast neutral radiated stainless steel material, which means short exposure for the same dose, is postponed to higher times. So you see generally that you need more time to fail material if you radiate in the fast neutrons, which means simply less exposure to the corrosive environment. Sample polishing does the same. If you polish a sample prior to the testing, you will simply observe that the cracking is composed to the higher times. And finally, from our own data, we found no significant difference between the time to failure of 40 to 80 dpa irradiated specimen. So this is quite a large difference between 40 and dpa in terms of irradiation. But we believe that this is simply because they have been exposed to corrosion conditions for about the same time. Thank you very much for your attention.